16th, 1777. August 16th, 1777, a day that changed history. But why Bennington, Vermont? What prize of victory could possibly warrant British General John Burgoyne to send an invasion army of almost 2,000 men to the small farming community in the foothills of the Green Mountains? August 16th, 1777 was a clear, hot summer day. General John Burgoyne developed a plan to conquer and hold the Lake Champlain-Hudson River line from Canada to New York City. The plan called for separating New England from the other colonies and thereby strangling the American rebellion. The plan called for Burgoyne to come down from Canada with his half-English, half-German army to Albany. Colonel Barry St. Ledger would come from the west, enlisting the aid of the Mohawk Indians on the way to Albany. And Lord Howe would come up the Hudson from New York City and join forces with Burgoyne and St. Ledger at Albany. Burgoyne was carrying out his part of the plan, but the other two parts failed. Lord Howe never started up the Hudson. He moved south to take Philadelphia and was unable to disengage combat from Washington and New Jersey until it was too late. Colonel St. Ledger, moving in from the west, was stopped by brave Americans at Oriskany and Fort Stanwix, near what is now Rome, New York, and retreated north back to Canada. This left Burgoyne alone to win or avoid defeat. As planned, Burgoyne moved down from Montreal and invaded Fort Ticonderoga. He forced the Americans to retreat and move south. On July 7th, Burgoyne ordered Major General Baron von Riedesel to attack the Americans at Hubbardton, Vermont. Colonel Seth Warner and his Green Mountain boys put up a spirited fight. Colonel Warner was a commissioned officer in the Continental Army and was ordered to fight a delaying action. He did his best. Von Riedesel's five German regiments were overwhelming, and the Americans once again were forced to retreat. At this point, we might ask, why were the Germans fighting with the British? Britain's worldwide ambitions at that time were many. They needed soldiers. King George III of Great Britain was also a prince of one of the many principalities into which Germany was then divided. King George was able to purchase the services of troops from other principalities. One of the areas in Germany at that time was Hesse. Most of the Germans who fought at Bennington were from Brunswick, but as it turned out, the early Americans called all the Germans Hessians. Many of these troops brought their wives and children with them. As Burgoyne continued his invasion south, the families, plus camp followers who had to be fed for their services, such as cooking, sewing, and laundry work, proved to be a drain on Burgoyne's supplies. He added to his problems by allowing himself dozens of wagons of personal baggage for he and his officers, including a complete traveling wine cellar, one of the many reasons he was called Gentleman Johnny Burgoyne.
The 25-year-old John Burgoyne was a man of many talents. A veteran of 30 years of military service, he distinguished himself on the battlefields of Europe. He was a master politician as a member of Parliament, and he was also a playwright. He was a representative of the upper-class families who dominated the political, social, and military life of 18th-century England. He was intelligent, handsome, humane, and very popular with his men. He permitted his officers the same privileges he enjoyed. He traveled with all the comforts of home, the best foods, servants, footmen, tailor, and his own personal gourmet chef. He passed this generous attitude through the ranks of his men. His less attractive traits were vanity and excessive ambition. His first tour of duty in the colonies was in Boston in May 1775. Burgoyne's service in Boston was undistinguished. He served under General Thomas Gage, whose troops were there under siege by the rebels. And it's ironic that one of those rebels was then Captain John Stark. Burgoyne returned to England that November, but before he left, he proposed to General Gage his master plan for the invasion of the Champlain and Hudson Valleys.
Burgoyne's supplies were coming south out of Canada down Lake Champlain. The barges only carried 4 weeks' supplies. The lake voyage took 5 weeks. His situation was not desperate yet, but his need for supplies was a continuing concern. After Hubbardton, Burgoyne set up headquarters at Skenesborough and received some ill advice from his good friend, Philip Skene. The English-born Tory suffered from delusion that almost all Americans were loyalists and would remain faithful to England and the King. Colonel Skene also advised Burgoyne there were great stores of supplies at Bennington. The site of that storehouse today is the Bennington Monument. In his effort to gain more supplies and territory, Burgoyne ordered the Fighting 9th Regiment to make an attack on Fort Anne. A crack regiment under the command of Colonel John Hill, he moved his troops to within 1 mile of Fort Anne. On the morning of July 8th, a bedraggled Yankee deserter appeared in camp. He declared his loyalty to the King and warned that Fort Anne had been reinforced by Colonel Van Rensselaer's militia, bringing that garrison up to 1,000 men. Colonel Hill's regiment only numbered 200. Of course, he believed the deserter, and why shouldn't he? Colonel Skene had advised all of the Americans would remain loyal to the King. Colonel Hill hurriedly dispatched a messenger to Burgoyne, back in Skenesboro, only 10 miles to the north. He advised the general he could hold his position until reinforcements could arrive. When next the colonel had time to notice, the Yankee deserter was gone. Half hour later, the Americans attacked. It appeared to be an American victory. This was foreign territory to Colonel Hill. The Americans knew it well. After the attack, the Americans regrouped for another. It was a shooting battle. The Americans did not have bayonets, and they had no intention of one-on-one combat with the well-equipped British. The Yankees had the British pinned to a hilltop when suddenly, through the crack of battle, came an eerie shrill. An Indian war whoop that was repeated and repeated again and again. The Yankees, on hearing it, picked up their powder horns and shot bags and slipped away. They were all too familiar with the war whoop of the Indian, which turned their thoughts to their women and children alone in isolated cabins on scattered farms. The Indians, it turned out, was a very clever, talented young British officer. He kept whooping and howling until every Yank was gone. Yes, the Yanks were gone, all of them, all 500 of them. This was half the number reported by the deserter spy. Burgoyne gained no supplies here. The Yanks, in making their retreat, burned Fort Anne to the ground. By the end of July, Burgoyne had become stalled for lack of supplies. He made headquarters at Fort Edward. American troops were building up strength around Albany. He was now desperate for supplies. It was at Fort Edward he got word. Americans had collected a huge storehouse of food, horses, wagons, and arms at Bennington, Vermont. If he could get those supplies, he wouldn't have to depend on that slow-moving supply line from Canada. He could then attack Albany and perhaps push south down the Hudson. And of course, he was still expecting help from Howe. Sending a raiding party 30 miles into hostile territory was a risk, but he had to get those supplies at Bennington. Burgoyne had little regard for the rebellious Yankee military skills, and after all, why should he? He pushed the Yankees south from Ticonderoga to Fort Edward. Burgoyne assigned Lieutenant Colonel Friedrich von Baum to head the attack against the Americans at Bennington. Burgoyne had received word from scouts that the storehouses at Bennington were poorly defended. Not expecting heavy resistance, he ordered Baum to just capture them and return with the supplies. Baum spoke no English, so Burgoyne sent British officers along to assist him. Baum's force of almost 1,000 men was made up of mostly Brunswick Grenadiers, men who did what their name implied through grenades. A large number of dismounted dragoons. They were light cavalrymen who were on the line of march to Bennington without horses. The uniforms were heavy and soon became a burden in the August heat. Some of these men wore their jack boots, heavy leather boots that went halfway up their thighs. There were two Hessian cannon pulled by horse. These Germans had a special interest in Bennington. They wanted horses. There were English marksmen, Canadian volunteers, Indians, and American Tories. Burgoyne had also sent loyalist Colonel Philip Skeen to advise Baum in dealing with the citizens of Vermont.
A letter dated August 10th, 1777, from General Burgoyne to Philip Skeen. Sir, I request the favor of you to proceed with Lieutenant Colonel von Baum upon an expedition of which he has command, and will march this evening or tomorrow morning. The object of his orders are to try the affections of the country, to disconcert the counsels of the enemy, and to procure a large supply of horses for the use of the troops, together with cattle and carriages. Lieutenant Colonel von Baum is to consult with you upon all matters of intelligence, negotiation with the inhabitants, roads and other means, depending upon your knowledge of the country, for carrying his instructions to execution.
Baum started his 30-mile march to Bennington on August 11th. As early as July 2nd, Colonel Seth Warner had requested help from the state of New Hampshire, advising the Committee of Safety of the many British victories and their closeness to the New Hampshire borders. He pleaded for help. The New Hampshire legislature acted quickly and called upon John Stark to command a volunteer army to help check the progress of General Burgoyne.
They chose their leader well. John Stark, a man without formal schooling, became self-educated in the wilderness of New Hampshire. John Stark and his four brothers became hunters, trappers, and then Indian fighters just to keep their scalps. There are many stories of his heroism. At the age of 23, in 1751, he was captured by St. Francis Indians when he became separated from his brother William and two friends. The Indians set up an ambush to capture the others. His brother escaped, one man was killed, another captured. Stark and his friend Amos Eastman were beaten and tortured. At the Indian camp, they were forced to run the gauntlet. Eastman didn't make it and was nearly beaten to death. Stark picked up a club and made his way through the line, knocking down Indians left and right. He made the gauntlet, scarcely receiving a blow. The old chiefs admired his bravery and dubbed him Young Chief. 4 months later, Stark and Eastman were freed for $163 in ransom, paid by Massachusetts officials who came to the Indian encampment looking for their own people. John Stark became a professional Indian fighter a year later and served with the British for 7 years, mostly in Rogers Rangers. He rose to the rank of captain while absorbing valuable military experience. He served at Ticonderoga when the British were defeated by the French. Shortly after, he gave up the soldier's life and married Elizabeth Page. He and his beloved Molly had 11 children. He settled down in Derryfield, New Hampshire, and soon became a community leader. Stark came to realize there would be no freedom for New Hampshire or any of the colonies under British rule. In 1775, being inactive for nearly 12 years, word came of the immortal battle at Lexington and Concord. He rallied 1,000 New Hampshiremen and rushed to Boston. Stark was now a colonel. At Bunker Hill, Stark and his New Hampshiremen twice stopped and routed the onslaught of a supposedly invincible British force. Through his shouts for victory, his men stopped the British a third time until their bullet pouches were nearly empty. Eventually, the Americans were forced to retreat. For the first time, the British felt the fervor and anger of men who would die for their freedom. Stark received little recognition for his valor at Bunker Hill. The Continental Congress promoted many junior officers, but passed over Stark. Finally, in frustration, he resigned his commission in March of 1777. A fighter and a patriot, John Stark answered New Hampshire's call, but not without conditions. He received the rank of Brigadier General, insisted on complete authority, and would answer only to the New Hampshire legislature. His terms were readily agreed to. Within a week, General Stark was in command of 1,400 men, including 156 of his Bunker Hill veterans. Stark set and baited his trap, but before deploying his troops, General Stark addressed his men. His reference to his wife, Molly, has become a famous passage in American history. There are the Redcoats, and they are ours. Or tonight, Molly Stark sleeps a widow. Stark's main line of attack would be at the bridge. He ordered two detachments to flank bomb. Colonel Samuel Herrick of Vermont and his famous Rangers were to come in from the south. Colonel Moses Nichols, commanding the New Hampshire militia, positioned his men to come in from the north. Units of the New Hampshire and Berkshire militia would attack a Tory redoubt, a fortification to Stark's left flank just before the bridge. Baum had placed a unit of English marksmen, all his Canadian Rangers, half his Brunswick Grenadiers, and a cannon on the road leading to the bridge over the Wallumsec. On top of the hill and quite a distance from the bridge, Baum placed all his dragoons and more English Grenadier marksmen. About 100 of his Indians were camped just north of the hill. The other half of his Brunswick Grenadiers, about 200 yards down the road to the west. Special troops guarded the area between the bridge position and the hilltop. Part of Stark's plan was for Colonel Herrick to sneak up on the dragoon emplacement and open fire. That was the signal for all the American forces to join in the battle with a uniform attack on the Tory redoubt and Stark's main attack on the bridge position. In order for Herrick and his Rangers to cross the river and come up from the south, they had to cross open field and would surely be noticed by Baum, who was positioned with the dragoons on the hill. Herrick and Stark worked out a plan where Herrick's 200 men would move in small groups across open ground. They hoped to surprise the enemy, giving them the impression they were disgruntled rebel militia returning to their homes, or better yet, loyalists coming to join the forces of the king. The plan worked. Tory advisors assured Baum that the civilian-clad musket men were local loyalists coming to join the expedition. Herrick's Rangers crossed the river and started positioning themselves for battle near the dragoon fortification. The Abenaki Indians and a small band of Mohawks became aware of what was happening and realized Baum was going to be trapped. Many of them quietly slipped away, even before the first shot was fired. The American force was waiting for that first volley from Herrick's Rangers to signal the opening of battle. As it turned out, that signal came from a most unexpected source. About 3 o'clock, Parson Thomas Allen, a minister with the Berkshire militia from the Pittsfield area, crawled up near the Tory redoubt to lecture and preach to the loyalists on their misguided patriotism.
And you, George, come out from the enemies of your country. They mean only harm. Come out. I demand an immediate and a total surrender now. Over yonder is the enemies of our country, of our free land. Think of what you're doing. I demand that you stand up for what's right for your country, for your home, for your wife, for your family. For the last time, I demand a total and immediate surrender.
A Tory shot at him. Allen was unarmed, but not for long. He immediately got a musket and fired back. He became a folk hero after that and fought as a soldier in the battle.
Number
What he didn't know at the time was, he gave the signal that started the Battle of Bennington. Herrick and Nichols opened fire on the Dragoon redoubt. Colonel David Hobart with New Hampshire and Berkshire militia and Colonel Thomas Stickney with part of a New Hampshire unit attacked the Tory redoubt. Seeing the Americans coming at them, the Tories became frightened and all fired at once. It was a fatal mistake. A musket took 30 seconds or more to reload. They suffered severe losses, but fought back as best they could. Flintlock musket was the basic weapon of the Americans, British, and the Germans. Commanders on both sides planned their tactics around its capabilities. A smooth bore rifle firing a loose-fitting ball, it was not accurate. A trained soldier could hit his target at 80 to 100 yards. He could load and fire three or four times a minute, that is, if he didn't stop to aim too closely. In order to get the most effective use of the rifleman's fire, lines were formed, usually in a standing or kneeling position. One line fired while the other reloaded and then fired, while the other reloaded and repeated the same action. Many of the Americans used the musket-firing long rifle, a more effective, more accurate weapon, but it lacked a bayonet, and in battle, the rifleman needed that added weapon. In the hands of a good shot, the long rifle could hit targets at astonishing ranges. The Americans used it most effectively, striking officers and harassing troops who thought themselves safe. Stickney broke off with his unit and headed for the bridge, joining General Stark, who had launched an attack simultaneously with the attack on the Tory redoubt. Stark took his force down the center of the road leading to the bridge, while sending others to cross the shallow Woolumsack to the right and left of his position. The Canadians broke from their position at the bridge and ran. It must be remembered the Americans were citizen soldiers, fierce fighters, but not the best disciplined. Their shouts and cheers were sometimes as frightening as their loud cracking muskets. On the other side of the bridge, about 100 feet from the crossing, the English and Brunswick Grenadiers abandoned a valuable cannon and ran west. Herrick and his Rangers, along with Nichols and the New Hampshire men, had the Dragoon redoubt at the top of the hill under fire. Baum with his Dragoons were well fortified behind log barricades. The Americans moved cautiously and slowly. Bullet or a sharpshooter found his mark. An ammunition wagon inside the enemy fortification exploded. He was taken to a house just east of the battlefield, where he died a day later. It was almost 5 o'clock when the last of the prisoners were rounded up. There was a lot of confusion and disorder after the battle. Some Americans were marching about with small groups of prisoners. Others were drinking rum Stark had provided, or enjoying some medicinal wine Parson Allen had captured from the Germans. Some of the men were enjoying the spoils of war promised by General Stark: clothing, guns, swords, boots, and shoes. Many of the men were just lying around on the ground exhausted. Huzzah! 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 Huzzah!
About 50 unknown soldiers, men from both sides, share a common grave here in the burying ground in Old Bennington. 222 of the enemy died that hot August day, almost 800 captured. Fewer than 40 brave Americans lost their lives or were wounded. These men were silenced by war, but their word spread. The word of victory spread throughout the colonies. American morale soared to new heights as floods of new troops enlisted in the Continental Army. Burgoyne tried to minimize the defeat, but it turned out to be the biggest loss of his campaign south. He did not get those desperately needed supplies, lost 1,000 men, and morale in the British ranks dropped accordingly. Burgoyne was so severely weakened by the American stand at Bennington, he was unable to recuperate. On October 17, 1777, 62 days after the Battle of Bennington, Burgoyne surrendered his entire army at Saratoga. A victory so impressive, the French came to the aid of the struggling new nation. If Saratoga was the turning point of the American Revolution, then the Battle of Bennington was truly the most crucial battle of the war. August 16th, 1777, a day that changed history.